Following this, in Saibu Town, Zhu and Molan ventured to the outskirts as it was deserted. Zhu had a wild idea to test the berserk potion. Molan asked if he dared to try it, to which Zhu replied, "I trust you. I'll take the risk." He urged her to stay away in case he couldn't control himself. Zhu drank the potion, and instantly, a surge of power coursed through him. He sprinted with incredible speed, leaving Molan awestruck. She wondered if her berserk potion was really this potent. Suddenly, Zhu reappeared before her, almost unnoticed. Impressed, Molan said, "You're fast." Zhu promised to keep providing her with materials and bid her farewell. Later, Zhu visited Zhu Lai Company, where a servant welcomed him and led him inside. They rode the elevator, and the servant explained that CEO Lu wanted to meet Zhu personally but had health issues that made her sensitive to wine. Zhu expressed understanding and mentioned the importance of the Red Crimson Moonbow project. They arrived on the 18th floor, where the servant showed Zhu the company's impressive creations, representing their top creativity. Then, Zhu was shown a unique set of armor and weapons, a black-purple armor and two dark-purple daggers made from materials of a rank 17 beast. The armor was simpler but had better defense than his current 3 Twilight armor, and the daggers had a penetration value of 16. The servant revealed that this gift was from CEO Lu to congratulate Zhu on his nomination as War God rank. Zhu felt it was too much, but CEO Lu appeared and encouraged him not to be humble. She asked why he seemed surprised to see her. Zhu confessed his surprise, complimenting Lu's appearance. Lu appreciated the praise and confirmed that inviting him to Zhu Lai Company was indeed to gift him the armor. She added that they needed his help with the protection umbrella in the burial area. Lu then got to the point, stating that if Zhu officially achieved God War rank during his battle with Kai Zhai Yong, Zhu Lai Company would be under his name. Meanwhile, in Dongbu Town, Zhang Ning was driving when he received news that Duo Lun had set out to assassinate Zhu. What he didn't know was that Zhu had already taken care of Duo Lun. While driving, Zhang Ning tossed a capsule onto the road, which would attract a horde of zombies. 3 days later, everyone was heading to the arena where Zhu and Kai Zhai Yong were set to battle. They also placed bets on the outcome. Zhu, at the Haiyang building, inquired about the bets to Shihan, who assured him that everything was settled. He then said, "I shall leave now," and Shihan, worried about him, reached out and touched his shoulder. Zhu patted her head, assuring her that he would be fine. At the entrance to the Dongbu Martial Arena, Zhu entered the arena, and Kai Zhai Yong, clad in his armor and carrying his sword, approached him, asking if he was ready to meet his demise. The audience cheered for them, and Zhai Yong thought to himself that although he could kill a palace rank assassin, Zhu seemed weak. He wondered about the armor and weapon made by Zhu Lai Company and felt that something was strange. He couldn't afford to be careless, he planned to end it quickly with a single strike. As Shen announced the start of the fight, Zhai Yong moved incredibly fast, charging toward Zhu. Zhu greeted him with a confident smile, raising his hand, preparing to use the disturbance skill. Among the audience, Zhang Ning noticed that Zhu was about to employ this skill again, just as he had done when facing Zhang Ning himself. True to expectations, Zhu unleashed the disturbance skill on Zhai Yong, rendering him immobile. The audience was puzzled, as Zhai Yong had been moving at lightning speed and suddenly came to a halt. Seizing the opportunity, Zhu drew his two new daggers and struck Zhai Yong. However, Zhai Yong's armor proved to be impenetrable, rendering the attack futile. Undeterred, Zhu swiftly employed 3 skills simultaneously from behind: dual slash, backstab, and critical hit. Yet, even with this powerful combination, only a fraction of Zhai Yong's HP was reduced. Zhu couldn't help but wonder if Zhai Yong had more than 300,000 HP. As the countdown for the disturbance skill descended, Zhai Yong regained control of his body. He taunted Zhu, inquiring if that was his trump card and expressing his disappointment that it couldn't break his defense. With astonishing speed, Zhai Yong launched a sword attack at Zhu, who didn't budge an inch to dodge it. Worried for Zhu, Shihan stood up in the audience. However, Zhu executed a macro dodge, effortlessly avoiding the attack. Zhai Yong persisted with a barrage of rapid slashes, but Zhu continued to evade using his macro dodge. Meanwhile, Zhu contemplated his predicament. "I can't seem to break through his defense. I wonder if a poison skill will work, just like in the game. Once applied, it becomes effective." As Zhu quickly dashed backward, he skillfully applied poison to his daggers. Zhai Yong lunged at him, and Zhu blocked the attack with his poison daggers. Zhai Yong scoffed, "Facing me head-on, you're courting death." Then, channeling his power through his punch, an explosion erupted. The audience couldn't see clearly through the thick smoke and thought it might be the end. However, Zhu surprised everyone by leaping into the air and appearing behind Zhai Yong. With his poison daggers, he struck Zhai Yong. In response, Zhai Yong attempted to counterattack, but Zhu skillfully evaded the strike. Despite the poison, it seemed ineffective against Zhai Yong's formidable defense. Zhu realized that breaking through Zhai Yong's defense or poisoning him would be no easy task. Thinking quickly, Zhu unleashed a flash-slash combo, teleporting to Zhai Yong. However, Zhai Yong blocked the attack with his sword and countered. Zhu dashed backward, realizing he couldn't keep up this way, he needed to change his strategy. Zhu began to circle around Zhai Yong, creating a tornado of smoke. Zhang Ning, watching the fight, noted that Zhu was attempting to create an arena that favored him. Even so, he questioned its effectiveness. Molan, who was also watching, understood Zhu's plan. He was using the smoke to conceal himself while he consumed the berserk potion she had created. After drinking it, Zhu emerged from the smoke, attacking Zhaiyang with a new weapon, the Death Scythe. He was now in a berserk mode, boosting his martial artist's stats threefold for 15 minutes. Zhaiyang managed to push Zhu away, but Zhu swiftly dashed toward him, countering with the Death Scythe. With a powerful strike, Zhu sent Zhaiyang flying. As Zhaiyang lay on the ground, he couldn't believe the strength of Zhu's attack and wondered if Zhu was truly only a rank 10 fighter. Determined not to admit defeat, he grabbed Zhu and launched himself, taking both of them outside the arena field. The audience began to question Zhaiyang's sanity and whether this action violated the rules. Shen intervened, calming the crowd and declaring that the victor would be the one who could return to the arena field. As they tightly gripped each other's hands, Zhu wore an evil grin and remarked, "Now no one can see us, it's time to end this." Zhaiyang responded by launching a ranged slash attack at Zhu. Additionally, he managed to poison Zhu with a poison called Zombie. The system displayed Zhu's HP bar with a zombie mark next to it, indicating that he would turn into a zombie. It also revealed that this zombie poison was different from regular poison and was considered a virus, strictly prohibited by society's rules. Zhu confronted Zhaiyang, asking if he dared to break the rules and use zombie poison. Zhaiyang laughed and retorted, "Rules. At my rank, can rules restrain me?" He continued with an evil laugh, stating that even if he used such methods, nobody would investigate the details of Zhu's death, people only cared about the outcome. In a surprising move, Zhu retrieved an HP potion from his inventory system and consumed it. Zhaiyang wondered where Zhu had obtained the potion and asked if he believed that drinking some strange concoction could remove the zombie poison. Zhu destroyed the potion capsule and replied, "Whether it's useless or not, you'll find out very soon." Then, Zhu employed his stealth skill in front of Zhaiyang, revealing it for the first time. Zhaiyang was stunned, exclaiming, "Disappeared. No way. How can a human suddenly disappear?" Zhu used the disturbance skill on Zhaiyang, causing him to reappear. Zhu assured him, "Don't worry, you're not the first one to die because of stupidity, and of course, you won't be the last." He then applied poison to his dagger and swiftly killed Zhaiyang. Afterward, Zhu returned to the arena, dragging Zhaiyang's lifeless body. Shen announced that through the martial arts battle, Zhu Zheng had been promoted to the War God rank. The audience erupted in cheers, and Shihan, along with Zhu's newest friends, celebrated his victory. Lu signed the Zhulai company under Zhu's name and commented, "It seems like my investment was right." Zai and the other members of the 7th team were overjoyed for Zhu's victory. They lifted him into the air, celebrating his success. However, while Zhu was airborne, they didn't manage to catch him, so he gracefully landed on the ground. Nevertheless, Zhu wasn't upset about it. He reflected on achieving the War God rank, thinking, "War God rank, I've finally reached this milestone. With more power comes greater responsibility." Later, Zhu lay in bed with Shihan, still lost in thought. She asked him why he seemed preoccupied after today's battle. Zhu got up from the bed and inquired if she missed home. Shihan hugged him and admitted that she did. Zhu reassured her, saying, "After I'm done with the burial area matter, we'll go back to Titan City." Shihan agreed with a beautiful smile. Afterward, Zhu returned to the dragon egg, remarking that it hadn't shown any changes despite consuming so many purple crystals. He questioned if it was being unreasonable. Then, Zhu took out three red crystals, the top-ranked crystals in terms of color. The egg accepted the crystals, and Zhu told it that if it could hatch soon, he would be there on time. Zhu later visited Shen's office, where he found Shen and his brother Yang. Shen congratulated Zhu on achieving the War God rank but quickly shifted to a more serious tone. He told Zhu that they didn't have much time to celebrate because there was an urgent matter at hand. Curious, Zhu asked what had happened. Yang explained that he suspected someone had tampered with this year's beast horde, causing it to arrive much earlier. The horde might reach the burial area in a few days. This turn of events was all because of Zhang Ning, as he was the one responsible for triggering the zombie horde by throwing the attracting capsule. The scene shifted to the old man harvesters who were busy with their harvesting duties. One of them wondered how long this beast horde would last, and his friend reassured him, saying that with many martial artists gathered, they could certainly block it. He continued, "We just need to collect crops in peace." The other one expressed his hope that the scale of the horde wouldn't be too massive. Meanwhile, the guards of the burial area were engaged in a fierce battle with the horde of beasts. They hurled explosives at the creatures, but the beasts seemed unaffected by the explosions. Then, two fighter planes arrived and successfully detonated the horde. However, a dragon suddenly emerged and unleashed its fiery breath, taking down one of the fighter planes. Among the people present, Zhang Ning thought to himself, "Zhu Zheng, did you see this? All of this is happening because of you. I don't mind letting everyone die to kill you." Simultaneously, Zhu was actively fighting against the monsters. Two fellow martial artists praised Zhu for his hard work, but he warned them not to relax, as the first round of the beast horde wasn't over yet. Soon, a group of giant poison zombies appeared. One of the martial artists noted that even in a beast horde, zombies wouldn't easily leave their territory, especially not with such formidable creatures. Zhu noticed that a similar situation was unfolding as what had happened in Y City. He instructed his companions to retreat, and he dashed off to test the capsule he found previously. Eventually, when he pressed on the capsule's button, the zombies turned towards him. Zhu realized, as expected, it's them, and memories of what had happened to his father flooded his mind. With determination, Zhu continued on his path, invoking Dark Shadow. Zhu wasted no time and immediately informed Shen that the Beast Horde had been caused by Dark Shadow. He also revealed that Jiang Ning, who is also of War God rank, was working with them. Shen assured him, "I'll send people to retrieve the capsule you have in your hand." Shen stated that if this was indeed related to Dark Shadow, then darkness would no longer prevail in the burial area. Meanwhile, Jiang Ning attacked a martial artist who was fleeing, demanding to know the whereabouts of Zhu Zheng. Nearby, Zhu commented, "All the zombies in this area have been cleared. I wonder how the town is doing." As he turned around, he noticed an HP bar nearby. Zhu wondered if a zombie had been missed, but the killing intent he sensed told him otherwise. Just then, Jiang Ning emerged in front of Zhu. Jiang lunged at Zhu, but Zhu skillfully dodged his attack. Swiftly, Zhu counterattacked using his dagger. Jiang Ning couldn't resist taunting Zhu, saying, "I've been waiting for you." At that moment, Zhu's anger flared, and the two engaged in a fierce clash. Zhu, thinking on his feet, used a stun skill to immobilize Jiang for a few seconds. However, amidst the chaos, Zhu sustained an injury. Without hesitation, he retrieved an antidote and applied it to his wound. Jiang, observing Zhu's condition, remarked that with such a wound, Zhu would succumb to bleeding soon. Zhu, with confidence and determination, assumed a fighting stance with his daggers, retorting, "Let's see which one of us meets their end first." Zhu swiftly used his stealth skill in front of Jiang, leaving Jiang stunned as he wondered how a human could suddenly disappear. While in stealth mode, Zhu pondered that Jiang had seen his greatest secret, and he was determined to eliminate him today. Zhu silently moved behind Jiang and employed the disturbance skill to immobilize him. Jiang contemplated whether Zhu could truly conceal himself, but he dismissed it, confident in his rank 18 martial artist status and the armor he wore. Zhu addressed Jiang, saying, "I know what you're thinking." He then grabbed Jiang's armor, challenging Jiang's assumption that he was safe because of it. Zhu removed Jiang's armor, applied poison to his dagger, and unleashed a series of slashing attacks. He declared, "Even if I can't break your defense, this amount of poison is enough to kill you." Jiang was struck by all the slashes and poisoned. Quickly, he retrieved an antidote from his small bag and consumed it. He remarked to Zhu, "Never thought. This antidote is thanks to the recipe you contributed. Its effect is astonishing." Jiang successfully cured himself. Jiang dashed towards Zhu with determination. In response, Zhu quickly consumed a berserk potion and swiftly moved backward to evade Jiang's attack. Zhu then used his blind skill to temporarily blind Jiang. Blinded, Jiang began slashing wildly at anything in his path. When a giant zombie approached him, he reacted instantly and killed it. He continued to eliminate the approaching zombies. However, when his vision finally cleared, an incomplete evolved zombie stood before him. As Jiang attempted to flee, Zhu suddenly appeared behind him, asking where he intended to run. Zhu used the disturbance skill once more to immobilize Jiang. In that critical moment, the incomplete evolved zombie seized Jiang and devoured him. With Jiang out of the picture, the incomplete evolved zombie shifted its attention toward Dongbu Town. Zhu remarked that by now, Dongbu Town's guards should have retreated to the burial area. With that in mind, Zhu descended, determined to return quickly to the burial area and provide assistance. Shen was busy marking the areas where the hordes were located when Zhu arrived. Zhu asked if he had investigated the capsule he had provided. Shen confirmed that he had and acknowledged Zhu's hard work during this time. Shen held the capsule in his hand and stated that it could indeed emit a signal that attracted zombies. After further investigation, it was revealed that Dark Shadow had lured poison zombies, and around 3 to 4 million monsters would be drawn to the burial area. Zhu expressed concern about the large number but noted that logically, the burial area should be manageable. However, he stressed the importance of sending people to destroy the metal rods. Shen explained that if it were just poison zombies, they wouldn't pose a significant threat. But if the Beast Horde grew to a large scale, it would become problematic. Zhu appeared somewhat saddened by the situation, but Shen reassured him by patting his shoulder and mentioning that his contribution with the potion recipe had been crucial. Shen added that the Beast Horde outbreak would last for 1 week and advised Zhu to get some rest. Without saying a word, Zhu turned to depart. Before he left, Shen informed him that the Dark Shadow organization had been eliminated by them. Zhu, wearing a serious expression, thanked Shen and then departed as well. Zhu returned to the place where the dragon egg was kept. He stated, "Father, the Dark Shadow has completely vanished from this world." Fragments of his father's memories flashed before him. And he added, "You can rest in peace now." His thoughts then turned to Su Yun, Lan Zai, and his friend Jiang. Zhu took out the Dark Shadow badge from his hand, commenting, "I have the rogue system. I can sever relationships and friendships and live alone." He squeezed the badge in his hand, remarking, "But I was wrong." With resolve, he turned the badge into ashes and stated, "In this world, what does it matter if I'm strong? Even someone strong will be overwhelmed when facing a formidable force." Suddenly, Zhu noticed that the dragon egg was behaving strangely. He asked the egg if it wanted to come out and offered it 3 red crystals. Zhu happily remarked, "This dense king aura, I won't be wrong this time." As he watched, the egg hatched, revealing a large and adorable baby dragon. Zhu was surprised and wondered why it was so large after emerging from the eggshell. He pondered whether he would have to feed it a lot in the future. The baby dragon began interacting with Zhu and then lunged at him as if seeking comfort from its newfound guardian. The burial area had just 1 week to prepare for the daunting task of battling 3 to 4 million monsters, and Zhu felt compelled to help. That night, he ventured to the outer city to spend time with his new baby dragon, whom he named Zhao Shu. As Zhao Shu frolicked around, Zhu called him back. The baby dragon responded eagerly, racing toward Zhu. In a playful gesture, Zhu tossed the steak meat into the air, and Zhao Shu skillfully caught and devoured it. Zhu remarked that they were fortunate to be in the outer city, as such a display would have caused quite a commotion. He emphasized the importance of staying low-key. He patted Zhao Shu affectionately and told him that since the moment he had broken out of his shell, staying low-key was no longer an option. However, Zhu's peaceful moment was interrupted when Shen contacted him. Shen informed Zhu that they had just received news of a new wave forming in the Beast Horde. The following morning, the new wave of monsters began attacking nearby towns, striking terror into the hearts of the people. In the meeting room of the burial area, Shen addressed the citizens, making it clear that a new, larger beast horde had gathered at Saibu Town, which had now fallen. Shen continued by stating that the burial area was about to face its greatest challenge ever, as the number of beasts this time was 5 times greater than any previous encounter. As the monsters approached the defensive walls of the city, martial artists, including Zhu, gathered alongside the firefighters to defend the burial area. They engaged the oncoming horde of beasts, fighting valiantly for 3 grueling days. Finally, despite their exhaustion, the martial artists managed to defeat the horde. At this point, Zhu used his stealth skill and disappeared, leaving the scene momentarily. That night, Zhu ventured to the outer city once again and summoned Zhao Shu. He apologized to the baby dragon, explaining that it was a critical time, and he could only allow Zhao Shu to come out at this particular moment. To his surprise, Zhao Shu had learned how to fly. As he descended, he greeted Zhu with a cheerful yo. Zhu understood that Zhao Shu was expecting a reward, so he took out a steak meat for him. To Zhu's amazement, Zhao Shu refused to eat it, prompting Zhu to remark that the dragon had become quite picky. However, when Zhu presented a red crystal, Zhao Shu eagerly devoured it. Zhu jokingly told him that he would become poor because of him. Despite eating a red crystal, Zhao Shu seemed unsatisfied and wanted more. Zhu then produced 3 blue crystals, but again, Zhao Shu declined. Zhu decided to check his inventory system and realized that Zhao Shu didn't eat low-rank crystals. He mused that the mutated plants he had gathered in the past must not have had star power. In his inventory, Zhu discovered some fruits he had pilfered while grinding. He took out 2 of them, noting that they had a dense star power, and asked Zhao Shu if he wanted to eat them. Zhao Shu eagerly consumed the fruits from Zhu's hand. As he ate, his eyes began to glow, and he started to grow larger, as if he was evolving. Zhu was astonished and asked Zhao Shu what had happened. Suddenly, Zhao Shu began causing explosions on the ground. When he finally stopped, he had returned to his baby form but was terribly damaged. In a hurry, Zhu jumped and summoned Zhao Shu back into his pet inventory. Zhu realized that the pet list in the system had a restraining ability, which could prevent any further issues as long as Zhao Shu remained inside. Sitting down, Zhu blamed himself for giving Zhao Shu fruits that he hadn't fully researched. When he looked up at the sky, he noticed another beast horde approaching. 3 days had passed, and the martial artists of the burial area continued their relentless battle against the approaching beast horde in front of the defensive wall. The horde showed no signs of retreating, and Zhu fought alongside the other martial artists. His presence was a source of inspiration for the fighters, who were thrilled to have him fighting with them. As Shen and Yang observed Zhu, Yang noted that Zhu Zheng was truly exceptional, displaying power that surpassed that of an average martial artist. Shen agreed but mentioned that even though Zhu was strong, his strength had limits. He expressed concerns about whether the burial area could endure this challenge. Suddenly, more than 2 Tyranodon beasts appeared on the scene. Shen urgently ordered everyone to retreat and defend the city. Zhu returned to the defensive wall, watching as the Tyranodon beasts relentlessly attacked and destroyed it. He couldn't help but ponder if they were allowing the same tragedy to happen again. With the defensive wall breached, the beasts poured into the city. The martial artists attempted to counterattack, but the Tyranodon beasts pushed them back with their immense strength. As more beasts, including flying ones, joined the fray, a sense of hopelessness began to engulf the martial artists, and they faced the grim reality of their survival being in jeopardy. Inside a building within the city, a husband embraced his wife and daughter, trying to reassure them that this beast horde would be driven away by martial artists, just like in the past. His daughter expressed her ambition to become a martial artist when she grew older. Her father encouraged her, believing that their daughter, Xiao Ling, would indeed become one in the future. Suddenly, a Tyranodon attacked, smashing a hole in their home. As the Tyranodon prepared to strike, the family watched in awe as a dragon appeared to protect them. The dragon fiercely attacked the Tyranodon, easily defeating it. It then soared towards the other beasts, eliminating them with ease. Meanwhile, Shen and Shang, along with the disheartened martial artists, watched in both fear and amazement as the dragon's presence seemed to change everything, casting doubt on the bleak situation they had faced moments earlier. The onlookers were shocked and elated to witness the dragon aiding them in the battle against the beast horde. The dragon displayed dominance, grabbing a Tyranodon and dispatching it with a blast of fire. Shen, taken aback, couldn't comprehend what was happening. The martial artists who had previously been filled with despair pointed out that someone was riding on the dragon's back, and it turned out to be Zhu, accompanied by his evolved Zhaoshu. Zhu swiftly commanded Zhaoshu to chase the mutated beasts out of the burial area. With a mighty roar, Zhaoshu ascended into the sky and dashed toward the Tyranodon and other beasts that had entered the city. From his mouth, he unleashed a focused, powerful stream of fire that incinerated the beasts. The martial artists rejoiced, relieved that they were finally saved. Zhaoshu continued to breathe fire at the remaining beasts until the entire horde began to flee. With only a few beasts left, the martial artists, after a week of relentless battles, took a moment to sit down and relax. The atmosphere was filled with cheers and gratitude for Zhu. However, Zhu reminded them that it wasn't the time to relax yet. While the beast horde was retreating, they needed to finish the job. He raised his hand and shouted, "The burial area belongs to us." His words stirred the martial artists' spirits, and they charged at the remaining beasts with renewed determination. Shen, acknowledging Zhu's mysterious abilities, turned to the cheering citizens and declared that, with power alone, they had saved the burial area. From that day forward, the burial area would forever remember Zhu's name. Shen raised his sword and rallied the martial artists, shouting, "Brothers, let's kill them all." 1 week later, the burial area was in the process of rebuilding its defensive wall and the city's damaged buildings. Meanwhile, Zhu, accompanied by Shihan, rode on the back of Zhaoshu. Together, they soared into the sky, heading towards Titan City. In Titan City, right in front of the Zhu Jai grocery store, Suyun was there with a child. When she turned and saw Zhu returning, tears of joy welled up in her eyes. Lan Zai, who had achieved the rank of Martial Artist 10, also arrived and rushed to embrace Zhu, overwhelmed with emotion. Back in the burial area, in a meeting room for the higher-ups, there was a discussion about Zhu's remarkable abilities. Shen analyzed Zhu Zheng's capabilities and proposed that, for the upcoming selection in the central capital, Zhu Zheng should be granted one of the quota slots. Shen agreed, pointing out that with Zhu Zheng on their side, the results of the Asian team could be anticipated and improved. A couple of weeks later, Zhu returned to the burial area city with Shihan, Lan Zai, and Suyun. Lan Zai was quite impressed, saying that the burial area was indeed very different from Titan City. Shihan complimented Suyun on her business skills, telling her that she was better at it than she was, and expressed her gratitude for Suyun's help. Suyun modestly replied, "I'm not that amazing, it's all thanks to Young Master." Then, Shihan smiled and gave Suyun some advice. She said, "In a world where no one can guarantee that we'll live to see tomorrow, you should have the courage to confess your feelings to the person you like." Suyun blushed and was about to respond when Shihan added, "Even though I don't want to share my lover with anyone else, I've heard a lot of good things about you from him." She then grabbed Suyun and said, "If it's you, I don't mind." Zhu, looking horrified, turned towards them and asked, "Why do I suddenly have a bad feeling?" Later, Zhu found himself in the burial area meeting room, where Shen apologized, saying they hadn't intended to disrupt his holiday plans. However, the discussion about turning Titan City into the burial area's vassal had gone smoothly, and Zhu Zheng played a significant role in it. Shen explained that this time, the central capital would select the war god team, and each region would send their 9 strongest martial artists to participate. Shen, with a serious expression, emphasized to Zhu that this time, they must succeed. After the meeting, Zhu stood in front of an airship, ready to depart for the central capital. His lover and friends were there with him. Before leaving, he turned to Lan Zai and said, "I'll be away for more than a year. You guys need to take care of yourselves." Lan Zai reassured him, saying, "Don't worry, I swear to protect everyone." With a smile on his face, Zhu bid them farewell, saying, "Wait for me to come back." After they departed, Shen mentioned that this time's selection would allow them to see martial artists from other regions. Zhu commented, "A gathering of geniuses, huh?" He started thinking, "Such a pity I'm not a genius, but even during the training period, I won't slack." Soon, they arrived at the central capital. When the airship landed, they were greeted by Tang Zhu, who was responsible for selecting their team and sending them to the training base. Tang Zhu instructed them to get into the car. However, he couldn't help but notice that Zhu was only a rank 10 martial artist yet dared to participate. He then informed them that the training would take place on the north side of the central city, about 30 kilometers away. All participants would train, practice, and accumulate points over the course of a year. He added, "Each month, we'll have point rankings to determine your standings." Zhu asked, "Will it be a closed-off, isolated training mode?" He was concerned that if he was stuck in one place for a year, his skills might deteriorate. Tang Zhu replied, "No, at the gathering center, you'll have your freedom. You just need to report in once a week." As the team arrived at the training base, the Highland City team was nearby. One of them informed their leader about the arrival of the burial area's vehicle and said, "According to what you said, Xiao Jianling, the leader of the hunt team from the burial area." should be able to fight with you. The leader responded, but I heard that the brothers Shan and Yang are even stronger. It doesn't matter, the top 10 rankings will belong to our Highland City. The burial area team exited the car, and Tang Zhu pointed out that they had reached the training center. He then showed them a ranking system and explained that it would refresh daily based on their combat abilities. Zhu thought to himself, since I came here, I must at least make it onto this ranking. Suddenly, a message came over the training center's speaker, announcing that all martial artists from each region should gather at the registration area to get registered. The martial artists began the registration process. Shen placed his hand on the martial artist rank scanner, which displayed his full name, Shen Yongxing, and his rank as 19. Two martial artists were impressed by Shen's rank, and one of them admitted he never thought the burial area was anything more than a mid-rated region. He hadn't realized there were experts there too. Then, Shen's brother Yang placed his hand on the scanner, and he also ranked as a martial artist at 19. When Zhu placed his hand on the scanner, his rank came out as 10. The martial artists around him were stunned and exclaimed, "Are you joking? Rank 10 also dares to come." After completing the registration process, each martial artist received a strategic watch, which served as their identity and had various functions. The martial artists started discussing the refreshed rankings. The first place was held by Chu Fei with an impressive 12,671 points. Jian Liang commented, "The gap between first and second place doesn't seem that big. But isn't Chu Fei just incredibly amazing?" Zhu added, "Yang is only ranked 17th, and Shen is even worse at 30th place." Dong Wai was frustrated and asked, "How are these ranking points decided? Why am I ranked 56th? Zhu, with an awkward expression, advised him to be content and pointed at himself. Zhu had the lowest rank, with only 31 points. Even the second lowest had 2,971 points. Others began mocking Zhu, questioning why he even came there. With an evil expression, Zhu thought, "It's just the starting point. When the time comes, we won't know who's last." On a tree branch nearby, two high-level martial artists were observing the scene. One of them asked his friend, Kang Zai, what he thought about it. Kang Zai responded, "It was unexpected. At least it isn't weaker than America. But that lowest-ranking martial artist, Zhu Zheng, is only a rank 10, yet he's participating in this gathering." His friend, with a cold tone, asked him why he was looking down on Zhu. Kang Zai clarified, "No, I think he's interesting." His friend cautioned him, reminding him that none of the martial artists who could enter the training center were simple. He suspected that Zhu Zheng was no exception. With that, he used his star power to levitate and said to Kang Zai, "Let's go. Tomorrow, when the training begins, we'll find out." The next day, all the martial artists gathered in front of the training center. Kang Zai introduced himself as Kang, their instructor for the year. With an evil expression, he bluntly said, "You are geniuses in your own areas, but from what I see, you are all trash." While this upset many, Zhu listened quietly. Kang continued, "If you're not happy with that assessment, you can challenge me. If you defeat me, I will request from the central city to ensure you get into one of the top three positions." He then exuded his martial aura, reminding them, "I'm ranked third in the central city's martial artist rankings, at rank 23. No one dared to challenge him. Kang proceeded to explain the rules for earning points. He mentioned that challenges would take place in a special martial arena, with the rule that there shouldn't be any fatalities. Otherwise, even if you defeated your opponent, you wouldn't earn any points. Kang outlined the training rules. First, increase your martial artist rank. Second, accept missions. Third, record the quantity and rank of mutated beasts you kill. And lastly, challenge high-ranking martial artists. Victory in a challenge would earn you 1/10 of your opponent's points, while failure would result in losing 1/10 of your own points. Kang emphasized that points would be counted daily, and after a year, your points would officially determine your ranking. Detailed information could be viewed on their strategic watches. He added, "I'm someone who values freedom. I won't restrict you, everything depends on self-discipline." With an evil grin, he concluded, "I hope you all strive to earn higher points." Later, Zhu was inside his room, examining the information on his strategic watch. He commented, "I never thought there would be so many ways to earn points." Then he noticed that the training location was an island, specifically Kyushu Island for martial artists ranked 20 and above. Zhu, impressed, wondered how dangerous this island could be. To his astonishment, he saw that not only Chu Fei but many martial artists were heading to Kyushu Island, including Shen and Shang. Seeing this, Zhu decided it was time to work even harder. He went outside to meet Shen and expressed his concern, telling him to take care during the missions. Shen replied, "Don't worry, I'm still anticipating that you will give me a big surprise during this training." With that, Shen headed to Kyushu Island. Tang Zhu approached Zhu and asked if he wanted to request a vehicle to go to the central city. Zhu confirmed his request. Curious, Tang Zhu asked if he wanted to reconsider, explaining that there was a suitable training location just 100 kilometers away. Zhu declined, saying, "To me, the central city is more interesting." So Tang Zhu arranged a vehicle for Zhu. As Zhu drove away, he pondered his strategy. He realized that if he wanted to catch up to those ranked higher, he couldn't kill beasts in the same areas as them, unless they were large-sized beasts. Otherwise, he needed to prioritize becoming stronger himself. Zhu arrived at the central city and headed to the Martial Artists Guild to gather more information. As he checked the computer, he remarked, as expected of the central city, it has all types of materials and potions. Even Molan's berserk potion can be found here, but it's so expensive, one bottle for one low-rank red crystal. Despite the high cost, Zhu decided to purchase all the berserk potions and some antidotes. 10 minutes later, he left the guild, saying, I'm back to being poor, but I can finally begin training. The scene shifted to the director of the training center, with Tang Zhu beside him. Tang Zhu informed the director that Zhu had requested to go to River Valley Plain. The director responded, that's a rank 16 beast area. This Zhu Zheng is indeed not simple. Let's see how well he does. Meanwhile, Zhu was flying on his dragon, Xiao Shu. Upon arriving at River Valley Plain, he ordered Xiao to land. As soon as he touched the ground, he found himself surrounded by a group of rank 16 fluorescent wolves. Zhu immediately drank the berserk potion and charged towards them, ready for a fight. The next day, Tang Zhu showed the director the points ratio for the day. The director was impressed to see that the top-ranked Chu Fei had increased his points by 3,000. But the highest increase was from Zhu Zheng. The director was curious about Zhu's growth and how a rank 10 managed to defeat monsters of rank 16. He commented, as expected, the burial area won't send a weakling to represent them. 6 days later, Zhu had raised his rank to 12 and was now ranked 138th in the overall ranking. Back at the training camp, others were shocked at how quickly he had increased his rank by 2 and climbed to rank 138. Zhu went to the canteen, where he was eating alongside Shen and Jia Liang. While Zhu was eating, a martial artist named Zhang Wei from Hurricane City, ranked 18 and 197th in the overall ranking, became angry and shouted that he wanted to challenge Zhu. Others were stunned by the audacity of a rank 18 challenging a rank 12, accusing him of trying to bully weaker martial artists. Jia Liang suggested Zhang Wei challenge him instead, but Zhang Wei persisted, asking Zhu if he dared to accept the challenge. Zhu finished his meal and replied, "Someone's rushing to give me points. Why wouldn't I dare to accept?" Zhang Wei sent the challenge to Zhu using the strategic watch. Jia Liang suggested that there was no need to accept such a dull fight, but Zhu decided to take the challenge. He reassured Jia Liang not to worry, saying he knew what he was doing. Jia Liang then wished Zhang Wei good luck, and this made Zhang Wei quite nervous. The following day, preparations were made for the fight between Zhu and Zhang Wei. Jia, one of the martial artists, set up a betting table and called on others to place bets on the match. One martial artist bet a red crystal on Zhang Wei, while Dong Wei bet 3 red crystals for Zhu. Jia Liang joined in and bet 3 black crystals. A quick note, black crystals had become the top-ranked crystals in the crystal color ranking in previous chapters. Jia's friend whispered to him that now more than half the bets were on Zhang Wei, and they wouldn't earn much even if Zhang Wei won. Jia responded that he needed more people to bet on Zhang Wei so they could make money. His friend asked if Zhu Zheng would win for sure, and Jia laughed, saying he never claimed that. The director and 2 other judges were present to watch the fight. As the fighters entered the field, the director called out to Zhu. Zhu thanked him for his hard work. The director contemplated that Zhu Zheng was only ranked 12, but he gave off an unfathomable feeling. He wished Zhu good luck. In the field, the director announced the challenge rules. The victor would receive 10% of the loser's points. Zhu Zheng had 21,241 points, while Zhang Wei had 18,940 points. Then, the director officially started the fight. Zhang Wei raised his sword towards Zhu and told him he didn't have a grudge against him but that he should be more humble next time. Zhu took out his daggers and responded, "Okay, because of what you said, I won't harm you later." Zhang Wei dashed towards Zhu, channeling his star power through his sword. But Zhu easily dodged the attack by stepping aside. Zhu then channeled his star power through his daggers and dashed towards Zhang Wei. Zhang Wei counterattacked with a fast swing of his sword, but Zhu's quick reflexes allowed him to block it in time. Then Zhu unleashed a lightning-fast flurry of attacks, moving so quickly that Zhang Wei couldn't even see his movements. In the blink of an eye, Zhu was behind him, his dagger poised at Zhang Wei's neck. Chu Fei, the top-ranked martial artist, was also present and commented on Zhu's strength, saying, "So strong." Zhang Wei dropped his sword, conceding the match, and the judge announced Zhu Zheng as the victor. Zhu's points increased to 23,213 points. The next morning, Zhu woke up at 6 a.m., went to the canteen, and found Jia. Jia invited him to sit down, and Zhu greeted him with a good morning. Jia jokingly remarked that he had been waiting for over an hour for Zhu. Zhu sat down, and Jia thanked him, saying that he had earned a significant amount because of him. Zhu replied, "Mainly because brother Jia has good eyesight." They raised their coffee cups, and Jia proposed that after the training, he would invite Zhu to visit the central city. They clinked their coffee cups in agreement. Zhu accompanied Jia to the helicopter as he left for his training, bidding farewell to Jia. After Jia's departure, Zhu commented that he should also go earn some points. He dashed deeper into the forest where no one could see him and summoned Xiao, telling the dragon that they were heading to the desertification area. With that, Xiao took off. Meanwhile, a member from the Hurricane City team informed his leader that Zhu hadn't requested the training center's vehicle for the day. The leader asked for confirmation, and the team member assured him that the training center staff had provided this information. The leader then instructed the team member to inform everyone else and notify him immediately if they received any updates about Zhu's whereabouts. The leader also expressed doubts about Zhu grinding elsewhere and remarked that he might be putting himself in danger if he did. Zhang Wei asked the leader why they needed to harm Zhu Zheng. The leader replied by inquiring if Zhang Wei thought Zhu Zheng was strong. Zhang Wei acknowledged Zhu's strength, mentioning his unique footwork and powerful attacks, which made a strong impression on him. The leader explained that every tree needs to go through a growth period before becoming significant, and they needed to cut Zhu down before he became a bigger threat. Meanwhile, Zhu Zheng arrived at the territory of the rank 19 Dragon Crawlers. He commented on the potency of the Dragon Crawler's poison. As he ventured further, he encountered martial artists from the Business Alliance engaged in a fierce battle with a Dragon Crawler. Sansai was in danger of being killed by the creature when their leader intervened, pushing him out of harm's way and throwing a net at the Dragon Crawler to buy some time. Both of them were poisoned in the process, and the leader advised Sansai to use his star power to counteract the poison. However, Sansai replied that he couldn't. As Zhu observed the situation, he thought about the Business Alliance and its reputation as one of the major forces in the central capital. He saw an opportunity to establish a friendly relationship with them. So, he took out a healing potion from his pocket and indicated that it could save both of them, suggesting that it would be a better solution. Zhu approached the group, and the leader asked about his identity. Zhu showed them a healing potion, saying, "I've got a way to cure your poison." He then gave the potion to Sansai and the leader, and the poison disappeared instantly. The leader expressed gratitude to Zhu for saving them. Later that night, they set up a campsite, and while sitting around the fire, Sansai thanked Zhu for saving his life and offered his assistance in the future. Zhu humbly responded that he had come to hunt and couldn't simply walk away from people in need. The leader questioned if the area was dangerous for Zhu, considering his rank. Zhu then revealed his strategic watch, which left them astonished and indicated he was participating in the training center. The leader apologized, acknowledging that Zhu was qualified to hunt there. The next morning, Zhu bid them farewell, and the leader asked if he wanted to join them in hunting dragon crawlers due to the value of their poison. Zhu declined, explaining that his combat method was different, and he preferred to hunt alone. With that, Zhu departed. Later on, Zhu found himself facing a dragon crawler. He commanded his dragon, Zio, to attack the creature, and he joined the battle. A week later, after hunting dragon crawlers, Zhu had gathered 10 bottles of their poison. He returned to the Martial Artist Guild's trading area and noticed a martial artist carrying a signboard offering to buy dragon crawler poison at a high price. Zhu approached him and suggested they find a secluded spot to talk. In their private conversation, the buyer informed Zhu about the current market price for dragon crawler poison, which was 2.5 high-rank red crystals. He could only offer 2 crystals but explained that it would still be a better deal than selling on the open market due to the savings on handling fees. Zhu agreed to the price but questioned whether the buyer could afford all the poison he had. The buyer asked how many bottles he had, and Zhu displayed the considerable quantity, surprising the buyer. Zhu sold as much as the buyer could afford and repeated this process with other interested buyers. Meanwhile, at the Business Alliance headquarters, the boss was furious because they were the primary sellers of dragon crawler poison, but Zhu's lower prices were undermining their business. The boss instructed Atian to investigate and find out who was supplying these poisons. Angrily, he added that they should buy up all the poisons and then raise the price. That day, the price of poison kept rising as Zhu continued to sell. The following day, after the Business Alliance had bought all the poison bottles, they noticed the price beginning to drop, and interest in buying poison decreased. Simultaneously, in the Martial Artist Guild, Zhu completed selling his last poison bottle. He expressed regret, saying he didn't want to make them suffer but accused them of being too greedy. He warned that those who got involved would face trouble. With a smile, he stated he had stirred up the market at the right time and left peacefully. As he exited the guild, Zhu commented on the Business Alliance's impressive speed in taking action and mentioned that he had made enough money for them to stay in the area. Afterward, Zhu decided to purchase the entire beach villa area. Once the deal was done, he invited his family and friends to the villa and met them at the central city's airport. Zhu's friend Zhang couldn't believe how quickly Zhu had made this happen and playfully asked, "You've only been here for a short while, and you're already this impatient." Zhu responded by giving him a friendly punch in the chest. Another friend, Jan Hu, wondered why Zhu had asked them to come to the central city. Later, Zhu brought them to the beach villa area he had bought, and Jan Hu was astonished that Zhu had given them the entire mansion to stay in. Zhu explained that this was just the first step, as he had also purchased a tall building because he wanted to start a company. He emphasized that having their own base was essential if they wanted to establish a firm presence in the central city. This revelation shocked Zhu's friends. Sai inquired about the cost of a building in the central city, and Zhu revealed that he had paid 5 high-rank black crystals for it, but he believed it was worth the investment. He then declared that from that day forward, the company's name would be Starlight. 5 days later, Zhu and his friends were camping outside when he checked his rank and realized he had been surpassed by many others. Zhang reassured him not to worry and to focus on his training, reminding him that the Starlight team had their support. Sai chimed in, emphasizing that Zhu needed to concentrate on his training. Zhu stood up, telling his friends, "Okay, brothers, I'll leave the Starlight team in your hands. I'm off." He then climbed onto the back of his dragon, Zio, and flew away. Later, Zhu found himself in a battle with giant water snakes. He spent the day skillfully dispatching the snakes, showcasing his combat abilities. As a result, Zhu's rank began to rise. The director, who was observing his performance, commented that Zhu Zheng undoubtedly possessed a combat ability within the top 50 martial artists. Half a month later, Zhu had spent the entire period battling the snakes and had reached the rank of 13 martial artist. When he checked his ranking, he felt that he could finally take a break. Zhu headed to a nearby forest, set up a campfire, and waited for his food to cook. He relaxed and mentioned that the system package he had was a treasure for traveling. However, he soon noticed something approaching him. Close to Zhu, another team was preparing their campsite. As they gathered around the fire, the leader caught a pleasant aroma and wondered aloud why the lone person nearby seemed so relaxed. The leader had already sent Lao Xu to investigate Zhu's presence. When Lao Xu returned, he reported that there was only one guy, a mere rank 13 martial artist. The leader was irritated by this seemingly arrogant individual who was eating hot food and lounging so casually. He commented that the place wasn't a tourist spot and ordered Lao Xu to bring a few brothers to teach him a lesson and remind him of the world's rules. Lao Xu and his friends approached Zhu with their weapons drawn. Zhu questioned their intentions, to which Lao Xu replied, "We will let you understand the cruelty of this world." The others rushed at Zhu, launching an attack. But Zhu's swift movements allowed him to disappear and reappear behind the man who had destroyed his bed. Without hesitation, Zhu killed the aggressor. Only the leader and two of his members remained. The leader, clearly upset, seized one of his comrades and asked how they had died when Zhu was just a rank 13 martial artist. Zhu approached them, mocking their disbelief that a rank 13 martial artist could kill. He then ordered his dragon, Zio, to eliminate them all with a fiery breath. Zio did so promptly. Afterward, Zhu looted their belongings and checked his watch, noticing that the point gap had widened, making it necessary for him to work harder. Zhu headed to the Devil Swamp to earn more points. However, he wasn't alone, as the Hurricane City's team was also present. Zhang Wei suggested to the leader, Zhang Ruocheng, that with their help, even a rank 20 long-nosed boar would be easy to handle. They heard fighting sounds nearby, and Zhang Ruo immediately rushed toward the commotion. Meanwhile, Zhu was engaged in a battle with the rank 20 long-nosed boar. In the midst of the fight, he noticed someone approaching. Zhang Wei identified the newcomer as Zhu Zheng. The team's intention was to eliminate Zhu, but Zhang Ruo advised Zhang Wei not to rush and to wait. As Zhu fought the boar, he employed a relentless attack strategy and demonstrated his skillful macro dodge to evade the boar's strikes. Zhang Ruo observed Zhu's fighting techniques and pondered the skillful execution of the macro dodge. However, he also questioned the significance of Zhu's rank and his potential to reach rank 20. Before Zhang Ruo could complete his thoughts, Zhu successfully broke the boar's armor using a flash-slash combo. This accomplishment shocked Zhang Ruo, who declared it impossible. Zhu then jumped into the air and delivered a backstab skill to the boar, ultimately defeating it. Zhang Ruo realized that Zhu had remarkable potential and decided that they needed to eliminate him before he grew even stronger. He became resolute, stating that they must kill Zhu, as only by doing so could he maintain his position within the top 5 rankings. Zhu noticed that Zhang Ruo's HP bar had turned red, indicating he was now hostile. Without hesitation, Zhu jumped and began to run away. However, Zhang Ruo quickly closed the distance between them and launched an attack using his fist. Zhu realized he couldn't dodge in time and opened his system's window to check his available skills. Zhang Ruo's powerful punch hit Zhu, sending him flying. Zhang Ruo was convinced that he had landed a decisive blow, but he couldn't see any blood or significant damage. What he didn't know was that Zhu had used a skill called Damage Transfer, a level 125 skill that allowed him to transfer all damage received within 3 seconds to a metal bracelet he was wearing. Zhu thanked Zhang Ruo for unwittingly helping him escape and immediately dashed into the nearby forest. Zhang Ruo tried to chase after him, but Zhu managed to elude him completely, leaving no footprints. Zhu used stealth to hide behind a tree. Zhang Ruo then communicated with his team members and informed them that they needed to leave. Once they had gone, Zhu took out the broken bracelet and muttered, "Zhang Ruocheng, you did it first, don't blame me." Just as he contemplated his escape, his communication device started ringing, and when Zhu answered, he was informed that something terrible was happening. In the midst of the chaos, Lan Zai collapsed to the ground as martial artists from the Bright Wing Company attacked him. Zhang was concerned for Lan Zai's well-being and moved to check on him, but a sword was swiftly placed at his neck, preventing him from taking any action. A martial artist named Hua stepped forward, scolding Lan Zai for acting cocky despite his lower rank. Zhang attempted to negotiate, suggesting that they could peacefully resolve the situation or even leave the territory they had occupied. However, Hua seized Lan Zai by the head and declared that they were from the Central City's Rank 3 Bright Wing Company. He insisted that they surrender their weapons and armor in exchange for their lives. Zhang responded by refuting Hua's offer, stating that they were no longer children and that even with the backing of the Bright Wing Company, they would eventually regret their actions. Hua grew furious and threatened Zhang, but before he could carry out his threat, Zhu, the captain of their group, arrived on the scene. Zhu's friends were relieved to see their captain come to their rescue. Huo, however, mocked the idea of Zhu being their captain, laughing at the notion. He approached Zhu, ridiculing him as a rank 13 martial artist and questioning if he had come to give them more money. One of Huo's companions leaped at Zhu from above, expressing his disdain for cocky individuals. In a swift and surprising move, Zhu teleported behind the attacker and stunned him. Two more of Huo's men rushed toward Zhu, but he coolly labeled them as dumbasses and promptly stunned all of them, turning the tables and making them his hostages. The scene shifted to the Brightwing Company, where the company's president, Chen Yunnan, was inquiring about why his men had been taken hostage. One of the employees informed him that Huo had provoked the other group, though they were unsure of the exact reason. The team had been captured alive, and the captors demanded a ransom of 47 low-rank black crystals for their release. Zhao Chongguang, the director of the company, immediately suggested launching an attack to eliminate the offenders. He couldn't believe that a small team had dared to offend the Brightwing Company. However, the employee explained that the other group had Huo in their custody and threatened to kill their hostages if any violence was attempted. Zhao Chong grew angry and asked whether they would dare to follow through with their threats even if left unhindered. The president inquired whether they had confirmed the details of the other party. The employee mentioned that they had dispatched people to gather more information. Suddenly, the employee's phone rang, and the information he received about Zhu Zheng left him shocked. He then informed the president that this situation had become quite troublesome. Back with Zhu and his friends, Zhang questioned whether the central city's top three ranking force would agree to the ransom demands. Zhu assured him not to worry, expressing his readiness to face any consequences. Huo warned Zhu that he wouldn't be so confident once the central city sent people to deal with them, but Zhu retorted that he was prepared to handle anyone who came. Jan Hu taunted Huo, emphasizing that his arrogance knew no bounds, especially his mouth. Zhu contacted Sanzai from the Business Alliance to get information about the Brightwing Company. Sanzai informed him that Zhao Chongguang had brought resources and left, leaving him to handle the situation alone. Zhu thanked Sanzai for the information and expressed his relief that the Brightwing Company was wise enough not to cross certain lines and engage in a fight with the Central City Minister. They understood the consequences and chose a smarter course of action. Zhao Guang stepped out of the car, carrying the 47 low-rank black crystals that Zhu had demanded. He was shocked to find that Zhu Zheng was behind all of this. Zhu pointed out his surprise at Director Zhao personally making the trip and questioned if he had brought enough crystals, warning that he wouldn't release anyone if even one crystal was missing. Zhao Guang chuckled and claimed he could handle them on his own, despite Zhu's assertion that he couldn't. Zhu raised his finger and confidently stated that Zhao Guang couldn't win. Zhao Guang accused Zhu of arrogance and asked if he truly believed that being a rank 13 martial artist qualified him to enter the training center and become the central city's opposition minister. Zhu retorted that his qualifications were not for Zhao Guang to decide. In response, Zhao Guang challenged Zhu to see if he could get the crystals himself. Zhu accepted the challenge, and Zhao Guang warned him not to blame him for his actions. Then, Zhao Guang declared that he didn't need armor or weapons to deal with Zhu and suggested that Zhu should attack first. Zhu drew his dagger and replied, "Then don't blame me for not reminding you if I strike first." With that, Zhu used his flash-slash combo, teleporting to Zhao Guang and using the stun skill to incapacitate him. After some time, Zhao Guang regained consciousness, realizing that Zhu could easily kill him in his weakened state. The director grabbed the bag of crystals and handed it over to Zhu, admitting his defeat. With that, the director took Huo and his men into his custody. Later on, Zhu went to a guild where he overheard people discussing his Starlight team's victory over the Brightwing Company. Zhu couldn't help but smile an evil smile as he entered a room with a computer. He contacted Liu and explained to her that the rank 22 materials she needed were quite challenging to obtain. Only a select few extremely strong martial artists in the training camp could hunt such materials. Liu understood the difficulty but expressed her belief in Zhu's abilities. She offered him a deal. If he could help them acquire the rank 22 materials, his future equipment would be even better than what he had at the moment. Zhu informed her that in the Central City's auction, rank 22 materials cost a rainbow crystal, a unique and dangerous crystal to obtain from high-ranked monsters. He acknowledged the value of the crystal and pledged to do his best to assist. With the call ended, Zhu contemplated the challenge of finding rank 22 materials. He realized that Kyushu Island was the only place where such materials were available, but there were already plenty of martial artists there. An idea struck him. With Xiaoshu, he could explore uncharted areas on Kyushu Island that no one had yet ventured into. Later that day, Zhu and his dragon, Xiao, took to the skies above Kyushu Island. Zhu directed Xiao to fly as far as possible to a place with fewer people. After a while, they landed in a snowy area, and Zhu donned appropriate clothing and gloves for the cold weather. Xiao began digging, ultimately uncovering a small, frozen, green beast. Zhu realized why Xiao had brought him there, understanding that his dragon often came to hunt in this place when Zhu wasn't around. He summoned his dagger and swiftly dispatched the frozen green beast, then searched its brain, discovering a valuable rainbow crystal. While Xiao feasted on the beast's remains, Zhu urged him to guide him to the place where he usually hunted. Xiao complied, and they journeyed together. Suddenly, a freezing tornado appeared in front of them. Xiao skillfully navigated through it without causing harm to himself or Zhu. This brought them to a new area filled with green-scaled beasts. Zhu couldn't determine the ranks of these creatures, but he recognized their strength exceeded his own. Xiao impulsively lunged at one of the green-scaled beasts and bit into it. Zhu scolded him, explaining that he had asked to be brought to the location for a different purpose. As the two creatures exchanged attacks, Xiao prepared to launch a fiery assault, while the green-scaled beast readied its own attack. In the face of this perilous situation, Zhu's rank rose to 14, marking his advancement as a martial artist. Realizing the danger they were in, Zhu ordered Xiao to cease the battle, fearing that they would lose everything if they continued fighting. Xiao obeyed, retreating by taking flight. While resting, Zhu reflected on the fact that he had finally witnessed the world of top-notch beasts. Xiao then regurgitated a massive scale from the green-scaled beast he had battled earlier. The scale was substantial enough to serve as the required material for Lu's task. After resting, Zhu and Xiao returned to the area where the green-scaled beasts resided. Xiao initiated an attack on one of the beasts, and Zhu followed suit with his flash-slash combo, swiftly followed by a stun to immobilize the creature. He then left the rest to Xiao, allowing his dragon to finish off the beast. They repeated this method for a week, and Zhu gathered enough rank 22 materials from the beasts. With his mission accomplished, Zhu set out on his way back. While flying on Xiao, Zhu noticed another type of monster running below. Nearby, the Da Jing team was present, led by Norich, a rank 24 martial artist. Norich informed his friends that he would go and investigate the beasts in the area, instructing them to return since this wasn't a suitable location for them. As Norich ventured forward, one of his friends commented that if Norich could break through to rank 25, he could become the best martial artist in their country. Shortly thereafter, Norich heard a loud sound. When he went to investigate, he discovered Xiao, the dragon, feeding on prey. He pondered where this huge beast had come from, as he had never seen it in the area before. Suddenly, Xiao noticed Norich and promptly flew away. Norich decided to salvage the leftover parts of the prey, remarking on the abundance of uneaten portions. Unexpectedly, Zhu approached him from behind and informed him that the prey belonged to him. Norich, perplexed by Zhu's presence, questioned if he was an Asian and noted that he was only a rank 14 martial artist. He dashed toward Zhu, launching an attack. In response, Zhu ordered Xiao to join the fray, shifting Norich's attention toward the dragon. As Norich focused on Xiao, Zhu executed a surprise move, dashing and leaping into the air. Norich wondered if Zhu was seeking his own demise, believing that this type of attack was futile against him. He questioned Zhu's intentions. However, Zhu utilized his disturbance skill to immobilize Norich. Recognizing that he couldn't penetrate Norich's defenses, Zhu created some distance between himself and Norich and instructed Xiao Shu to finish the encounter. With Xiao's swift attack, Norich was quickly defeated, and Zhu looted Norich's crystals and weapon. Reflecting on the encounter, Zhu lamented the loss of a powerful martial artist, acknowledging that he still couldn't match Norich's combat ability with his current skills. The scene shifted to an intelligence room, where a screen displayed that war god Norich had been eliminated. In the meeting room, Andrew, the Intelligence Center director, presented the information to Valoga, the head of the Eurasian Union Federation. He explained that Norich's life detection chip had been extinguished instantly in the area, suggesting that Norich was killed suddenly. Valoga inquired about the investigation's results, to which Andrew replied that the wounds on Norich's body appeared to be inflicted by a strange beast. However, Norich's weapon and crystals were missing, indicating that they might have been taken by passing martial artists. Valoga instructed Andrew to investigate the market and see if Norich's heavy sword was available for sale, emphasizing the need to uncover the truth behind the matter. Meanwhile, Zhu was en route to the burial area to meet with Lu. While flying on Xiao, he checked his system equipment, realizing he had 45 levels left. When he reached level 180, he would be able to wear all the god equipment. He also checked his watch and remarked that regarding the points, he was content to let others enjoy their period of being in first place. Zhu returned to the burial area and made his way to the Zhu Lai Company. The researcher there was astonished, as it was the first time they had seen materials of such a high rank. The researcher then confirmed that the material Zhu had brought was indeed rank 24. Zhu asked Lu if he had lived up to her expectations. Lu expressed her deep gratitude for the high-quality materials and assured Zhu that they would pay him accordingly. Zhu proposed that he could sell the materials to their company but had a request in return. He wanted to use the rank 24 material to craft a set of armor for himself, and in exchange, he would offer them 20% of the profit from these materials. Lu readily agreed to the proposal. Zhu then whispered to Lu about something important and asked if she would like to take a look. He emphasized the need for discretion, suggesting that it would be best if fewer people were aware of it. Lu instructed the security team to leave, and once they had departed, Zhu revealed a green scale that Xiao had vomited. Lu took it from Zhu and immediately noticed that energy was emanating from the scale, indicating that it was of at least rank 24. Lu then rushed to the lab and ordered everyone to evacuate. She placed the scale on a detection machine, which confirmed that the scale was rank 30. Zhu inquired if she found this revelation astonishing. Overwhelmed with gratitude and excitement, Lu hugged Zhu tightly. After realizing her actions, she blushed and apologized, explaining that the potential impact of this material on Zhu Lai was just too exhilarating. Zhu reassured her, saying it was fine, but he wanted her to use the material to craft two daggers for him. Lu agreed without hesitation and promised to personally oversee the task. 1 week later, the set of armor and daggers were successfully crafted for Zhu. Zhu inspected his new daggers, appreciating their impressive penetration value of over 30. Lu mentioned that they hadn't given the daggers a name yet. Zhu tested their capabilities by swinging them skillfully and decided to name them King Lin. At the Central City Training Center, the director informed Tang Zhu about a major change. He explained that the training center's mission platform had received official approval and would be officially launched. Tang Zhu, initially thinking it was a positive development, asked about the mission's purpose. The director, however, expressed concerns about the potential consequences. He questioned whether martial artists would negotiate amicably and work together when encountering missions or if they would compete aggressively. The training center's original goal was to identify the best martial artists, and surviving in the face of significant challenges was key. Meanwhile, Zhu was having a meal in the canteen when his strategic watch notified him that the mission platform had been officially launched. After finishing his meal, his team members joined him. Shen raised the topic of the new mission system, and Jian Liang expressed concerns about it. They anticipated that martial artists would begin forming teams to complete missions, and those who ventured out alone might become targets for other teams. Zhu suggested that they avoid direct encounters, as even when forming a team, there was no guarantee that their team would be stronger than others. Shen agreed, emphasizing the importance of safety. He recommended informing other team members not to rush into the mission system without careful consideration. Jian Liang added that while they might not be able to undertake missions, it didn't mean Zhu couldn't. He believed that Zhu and his dragon could handle missions in any potential encounters with other teams. Zhu acknowledged this and stated that he would select a suitable mission in due course. The following day in the training center, all the teams gathered to learn about the newly introduced mission system. There were three different missions available. First, kill the Silver Snake King with a reward of 30,000 points. Second, find 5 mutated purple flowers in the deserted land with a reward of 15,000 points. Lastly, retrieve a hard drive on the 67th floor of the Yang Xiaxing building with a reward of 35,000 points. Zhu carefully considered the missions and commented that all three of them seemed suitable for him, but the third mission was the most fitting. He explained that urban areas like that particular building street were likely infested with poison zombies, but it wouldn't be challenging for him. Zhu then checked his watch to see how many martial artists had selected each mission. He found that 30 martial artists had chosen the first mission, 127 had opted for the second, and approximately 50 had picked the third mission. Despite the competition, Zhu decided to select the third mission and remarked on the limited availability of the hard drives, as there was only one despite the number of participants. Following his choice of the third mission, Zhu, along with Xiao, headed to the Yang Xiaxing building. Upon arriving, Zhu checked how many other martial artists had selected the same mission. He discovered that an additional 63 martial artists had chosen the same task, making a total of 113 participants. Zhu leaped from Xiao's back and parachuted to land near the building. Meanwhile, Zhang Ruo, the leader of the Hurricane City team who sought to eliminate Zhu, and his team also opted for the third mission. They were at the airport, and Zhang Wai informed his leader that they had rented 4 fighter jets to transport them to the sky above S City. Zhang Ruo then decided it was time to go after learning that Luo Ping and the others had already departed. As Zhu descended near the zombies, he quickly ran towards his objective, leaving the zombies behind. He made his way through the building, ascending to the 67th floor. As Zhu opened the door, he triggered an alarm. Around the same time, Zhang Ruo and his team arrived above the Yang Xiaxing building and descended using parachutes. They were alarmed by the sound of the alarm, surprised that someone had beaten them to the mission. Inside the room with the hard drives, Zhu was unsure of which one he needed, so he took them all. He then hurried to the roof, where he saw Zhang Ruo descending. Zhang Ruo challenged Zhu not to run away, and Zhu responded with a cunning move. He grabbed a metal bar and playfully suggested that the falling speed was too slow for Zhang Ruo. Zhu threw the metal bar towards Zhang Ruo's parachute, causing it to malfunction and sending Zhang Ruo plummeting to the ground. Zhu watched Zhang Ruo survive the fall and commented on his tenacity. He then activated his flying wings and made a swift escape, leaving Zhang Ruo's team to check on him. Zhang Ruo's team inquired about his well-being, and Zhang Wai reported that Zhu hadn't taken the hard drive yet. Zhang Ruo ordered his team to clear the area of poison zombies before ascending the building to continue their mission. After dealing with the zombies, Zhang Ruo and his team ascended to the 67th floor of the building, only to discover that the room was completely empty. Meanwhile, Zhu was in the air, contemplating the need to modify his flying wings since they were too slow. As he looked down, he observed a large group of people engaged in battles with zombies. With a sinister grin, Zhu commented, "I hope you guys have a good day today." Later, Zhu arrived at the training center's mission reception office. The girl working there greeted him and informed him that he could request a mission using the tactical watch. However, Zhou surprised her by stating that he was there to submit a mission. She was puzzled, as it hadn't even been a day since he'd received the mission. Zhou handed over all the hard drives he had found. Back at the Yang Zaizing building, martial artists were still battling zombies. One of the leaders in the area urged his team to speed up, believing that with the alarm ringing, other participants were likely surrounded by a horde of poison zombies. He saw a notification on his watch, stating that Zhou Zheng had already completed the third mission. Enraged, he wondered what he had been doing the entire day. The training center's director, upon hearing of Zhu's swift completion of the challenging S-rank mission in less than a day, pondered how Zhu had accomplished it. He mentioned the information he had obtained and speculated that Zhu might have a formidable beast as his trump card. He mused about the other surprises Zhu might have in store. The scene shifted to Zhu, who was flying with Xiao. One of his friends contacted Zhu and praised him for his quick completion of the mission. Zhu modestly responded, "I was just lucky, I did it faster than them." His friend then asked about his plans, and Zhu replied, "Kyushu Island." Zhu was en route to the Silver Snake Valley on Kyushu Island, contemplating that top-ranked martial artist Chu Fei had also chosen the Silver Snake King's mission. He thought about the lack of an antidote for the mission and how it might pose a challenge for others to complete. Meanwhile, Chu Fei was sitting when one of his team members came to inform him that Yi Hong and his team had arrived in the east, while Su King Lin and the others were in the north. The team member asked if they should call Ok Xuan and the rest. Chu Fei, confident in his abilities, replied, "No need, I'm more than enough." His team member agreed, stating that no one could venture deep into the Silver Snake Valley's center, and they only needed to wait at the outskirts for the Silver Snake King to appear. They also noted that even if the Silver Snake King appeared on their side, only Chu Fei could defeat it. Just then, Chu Fei sensed a presence nearby and turned to find a Silver Snake. At the same time, Chu was making his way to the Silver Snake Valley, riding on his tiger, Xiao Zheng. Upon arrival, he noticed Chu Fei engaged in a battle with the Silver Snake. Chu Fei's team member informed him that Zhou Zheng had arrived. Chu Fei instructed him to focus on killing the snake. Zhou realized that Chu Fei's group intended to wait for the Silver Snake King to emerge, but he was unwilling to wait. Zhou began to make his way deeper into the valley, towards the Snake King's center. After Chu Fei and his member killed the Silver Snake, Chu Fei ordered him to collect materials while he decided to venture inside. As Zhou moved deeper into the valley, he noticed that he had been poisoned, even though he hadn't reached the center yet. He used a game potion to cure the poison and grant himself poison resistance, continuing his journey. The scene then shifted to Yi Hong and his team. One of them informed Yi that Chu Fei had entered the valley. Yi inquired if they were sure, and the team member confirmed that Chu Fei had indeed gone in. Yi decided to investigate as well and asked his team to remain outside. Back to Zhou, who was close to the valley's center, he observed many bars indicating the presence of numerous snakes, suggesting their vast numbers. Chu Fei approached Zhou and accused him of seeking death. Zhou retorted, saying that he wasn't planning to die from the poison, which wouldn't be easy. Zhou then proposed the idea of working together to complete the mission. Chu Fei questioned how they could collaborate, to which Zhou pointed out that they, along with two others who had arrived, likely Yi Hong and Su King Lin, could join forces to accomplish the mission as a group of four. Chu Fei was taken aback and turned to ask where Su King Lin and Yi Hong were. Shortly after, the two of them emerged. Chu Fei expressed his surprise, wondering how Zhou knew which two individuals had arrived. The four formidable martial artists had now gathered in one place. Breaking the silence, Zhou reassured them, reminding them that they were classmates and emphasizing the potential danger in waiting outside, where they could be ambushed. Chu Fei inquired if Zhou had a solid plan. Zhou went on to explain the strategy. The four of them would form a temporary team. Chu Fei, Su King Lin, and Yi Hong would wait at the entrance to the valley, while Zhou would lure the Silver Snake King out. Once the king was lured out, they would equally split the materials obtained from it. Yi Hong asked why they should trust that Zhou could lure the Snake King. Zhou responded by stating that his very presence proved his commitment to the plan. If he couldn't lure the king out, they could still proceed with the ambush without incurring any losses. Both Chu Fei and Su King Lin agreed to the plan, and eventually, so did Yi Hong, admitting that he couldn't lure the king but believed that Zhou could. Zhou ventured deeper into the valley, despite the intensifying poison. He used his stealth skill to scout the area and discovered three snake kings, one gold and two silver. The gold snake was their leader, although the mission required killing only one silver snake king. Zhou knew that disturbing any of them would cause a chain reaction in the valley. He considered the limited duration of the antidote, deciding to wait and see if he could lure the snakes. The three martial artists who were waiting for him outside the valley shared his view via the strategic watch. Realizing the danger inside, they grew increasingly concerned. After some time, Quinlan asked if they should contact him, but Chu Fei reminded them that they should wait a bit longer. Zhou returned to the valley and began luring the snake kings outside. As the martial artists and their leaders prepared to face the snakes, Zhou took a break to drink juice. He then offered instructions to the martial artists during the battle, guiding them to safety and directing their attacks. Chu Fei observed Zhu's expertise and noted that some geniuses simply defied common sense. The scene shifted to Zhang Ruo, who had requested information about Zhu from the city lord. The city lord contacted him and informed him that they had found information about Zhu. Before Zhang Ruo could share what he had learned, the city lord became furious and warned Zhang Ruo to reconsider his relationship with Zhu, emphasizing Zhu's formidable combat abilities. Stunned and horrified by the information he had received about Zhu, Zhang Ruo realized the gravity of the situation. Meanwhile, back with Zhu and the other leaders who had successfully defeated the three king snakes, Zhu flew with Xiao and asked Shen if he was sure he didn't want to join them. Shen explained that they needed to focus on increasing their combat experience to keep up with Zhu's progress. Zhu then landed with Xiao, and Su Quinlin marveled at the dragon Xiao, expressing relief that they had never provoked Zhu, as they wouldn't have known how to deal with him. Chu Fei added that Zhu was no ordinary opponent, and they lamented the lack of intelligence in Hurricane City. Zhu gathered the leaders because he had a plan to help everyone earn money and accumulate points. When they asked about the plan, Zhu introduced the idea of monster grinding and proceeded to lure 27 silver snakes back to the valley's center to implement the strategy. After 7 days, the rankings were updated. Chu Fei secured the top position, followed by Yi in second place, and Su Qinglin in third. Meanwhile, Zhang Ruo's rank had dropped to 9th, much to his frustration. Zhang Wai, one of his team members, tried to console him, assuring him that he could quickly regain his 4th place ranking. Zhu was currently ranked 78th. During a meal with the temporary team leaders, Su Qinglin expressed concern about the significant point difference between them and Chu Fei. Chu Fei downplayed it, emphasizing how easily they could overtake him. He then pointed out Zhu, acknowledging that Zhu's impressive speed could potentially lead him to surpass them. As Zhu perused the mission listings, he noticed an S-rank mission to steal phoenix eggs. He set off to the gravel gobi, the location of the phoenix eggs. Coincidentally, Zhang Ruo and his team were also at the same location, using binoculars to identify the phoenix's nest. Then they noticed Zhu climbing towards the nest, and Zhang Wai brought up the city lord's previous advice not to provoke Zhu. Zhang Ruo, after scanning the area again, concluded that Zhu didn't bring his huge beast with him, implying that if Zhu died, it wouldn't be their fault. Zhu managed to reach the phoenix eggs and quickly grabbed most of them. He left only 3 behind as he prepared to make his escape. That's when Zhang Wai took a shot at him using a sniper rifle. The gunshot alerted the phoenixes, who immediately realized their eggs had been stolen. With a fierce determination, they charged towards Zhu to protect their precious eggs. Zhu employed his stealth skill and vanished from sight. Zhang Wai expressed concern that they might soon be discovered by the enraged phoenixes. Zhang Ruo proposed they retreat first. Zhu suddenly reappeared right next to them. Zhang asked him if he could take them all on by himself. He continued, "Since you took the initiative to approach, it seems like you're looking for trouble." Zhang Wai wanted to dissuade his leader from confronting Zhu, but Zhang Ruo silenced him, emphasizing, "We have a deep grudge with Zhu Zheng. Even if we apologize, do you think he'll forgive us? Even without that huge beast, do you think he can defeat all of us alone?" Then, Zhu summoned his dragon, Xiao, and declared, "Take a good look. You must be blind. Who said my Xiao Shu isn't here?" Xiao let out a deafening roar, ready for a fight. Zhang Ruo reassured his team, saying, "His weapon can't break our defense. Ignore that beast. Let's work together to take down Zhu Zheng first." In response, Zhu drew his new daggers, Qinglin, and asked, "Are you really that certain?" Zhu swiftly attacked Zhang Ruo and shattered his armor, causing significant damage to him. He confidently stated that whether or not Xiao Shu was present, the outcome for Zhang Ruo and his team would be the same. Zhu then leaped to finish them off. After a while, Chu Fei received news that Zhang Ruo Cheng's entire group had been killed. Yi Hong reminded everyone about the risks of recklessness, emphasizing that some missions might come at the cost of one's life. They soon realized that Zhu was responsible for their demise, as he had chosen the same mission that Zhang Ruocheng's group had selected. Zhu returned to the training center's mission reception office to submit the mission involving the phoenix eggs. This accomplishment boosted his ranking to 41st. Exiting the mission reception office, Zhu decided to continue grinding for experience. A month passed, and Zhu Zheng reached the top 10 in the rankings. He had spent the past month hunting silver snakes for experience, but as the required experience to rank up grew larger, he decided it was time to change his hunting grounds. Zhu ventured into an icy region and encountered a formidable bear beast, ready to begin the hunt. 10 months later, at the training center's canteen, Chu Fei, Yi Hong, and Su Quinlin discussed Zhu's remarkable growth over the past 10 months. Zhu had become the number one ranked martial artist. Returning to the training center, he had now achieved the rank of 21 as a martial artist. In the training center plaza, the director assembled all the teams and announced the top-ranked participant of the training camp, Zhu Zheng. Shen and Cheng expressed their happiness for Zhu's achievement. The director then revealed the top 10 martial artists who would bypass the reserve service and directly serve as ministers in the central city. Zhu Zheng was also appointed as the captain of the Asian team. Zhu noted that he had finally reached this significant milestone. The director approached Zhu and praised his abilities, reminding him that leading the team wouldn't be simple. Zhu confidently replied that he would make the Asian team shine and prove its worth to other continents. Following this, a final mission was initiated in which only the strongest teams were allowed to participate. The mission involved retrieving the crystal fruit, and it took place at Naban Forest. George, a rank 26 martial artist and the European team's captain, instructed his members to search the area carefully, emphasizing that the crystal fruit should be located there. He drew his sword and reminded his team that, apart from them, the Asian and African teams, as well as the Eurasian Union team, also had information about the crystal fruit. George cautioned his team not to be careless. Meanwhile, Zhu arrived at the mission area and instructed his team, notifying them that he had reached the target range. One of his team members informed Zhu that the headquarters had detected the presence of the European team in the vicinity. Zhu casually mentioned that he didn't mind letting Xiao Shu pay them a visit. He then ordered Xiao to distract the European team. As Xiao appeared above the European team, George immediately realized that they were no match for this powerful beast. He had seen this dragon in their information before and now understood that it belonged to Zhu Zhen. Zhu silently observed the situation, pondering that now, only the African and Eurasian Union teams had yet to arrive. While Xiao Shu could easily snatch the crystal fruit, it would deny his team members the chance to gain valuable experience. Shortly after, a notification arrived on Zhu's watch, indicating the arrival of the African and Eurasian Union teams. Manhwa, a rank 26 martial artist and the captain of the African team, along with Lev, a rank 26 martial artist and the captain of the Eurasian Union team, joined the scene. Zhu returned to his team, and they reported that the crystal fruit was likely ahead, but a wall of vines presented a significant obstacle. Notably, Chu Fei, Yi Hong, and Su Quinlan had all joined Zhu's Asian team. Chu Fei remarked that the vines were troublesome but suggested that focusing on them might expose them to sneak attacks from teams of other continents. Su Quinlan added that the other continent teams were probably grappling with vine-related challenges as well. Zhu then shared his experience in dealing with this type of plant and proposed that, with a high penetration value weapon, they could easily open up a path. So, Zhu patiently waited for the vines to attack him. As they did, he executed dodges to evade their strikes and then promptly cut them. The other vines tried to overwhelm him in quick succession, but Zhu used his exceptional footwork, performing a series of macro dodges before efficiently cutting the main branches of the vines. He showed his team this effective method of dealing with the vines, emphasizing that by cutting their main branches, the task became easier and required less effort. Su Quinlan complimented their captain's footwork, impressed by his skill, while Chu Fei reminded him that Zhu's leadership qualities set him apart as the captain. Meanwhile, the European team was struggling to cut through the vines, and their efforts had left them exhausted. Simultaneously, the Eurasian Union team was also grappling with the vines. George decided to let his team rest for a while before continuing, especially for the sake of a member named Matthew, who was visibly tired. During this break, an unexpected incident occurred. An unknown assailant from the Africa team used a blowpipe to poison Matthew. George retrieved the dart and realized it was from the Africa team. The situation in the Asian team was notably different, with Yi Hong suggesting that they were making great progress and likely the fastest. Su Quinlan cautioned against complacency, but Zhu remained confident, noting that they should face whatever challenges came their way. Zhu suddenly noticed red HP bars approaching them, indicating the presence of enemies. He quickly informed his team to be on alert and stay put while he investigated the situation. Upon approaching, he discovered that the Africa team was headed in their direction. Behind Zhu, one of the Africa team members attempted to poison him with a blowpipe. Reacting swiftly, Zhu teleported to the assailant and used a stun attack to incapacitate him. Subsequently, he handled the remaining five members of the Africa team. Zhu returned to his team and reported the enemy attack, explaining that he had already dealt with a few martial artists from the Africa team. There was commotion nearby, suggesting that the attack was not limited to their group. The following morning, all the team leaders gathered together. George, the European team's captain, introduced himself and proposed that since everyone was present, they might have a discussion. Manhwa of the Africa team asserted that there was nothing to discuss and that outsiders should leave because it was their territory. George grew angry, reminding Manhwa of an unsettled issue from the previous night and warning that he shouldn't provoke all three parties. Manhwa responded defiantly, unafraid of potential retaliation. Lev, the captain of the Eurasian Union team, intervened, suggesting that no one had gained an advantage from the previous night's attack. He proposed that they adhere to the old rules, where whoever obtained the crystal fruit could keep it, and no one else would try to snatch it afterward. Zhu and the other team leaders agreed to this proposal. The teams ventured deeper into the forest in search of the crystal fruit. Zhu's team was concerned that they were at a disadvantage since the other teams had already advanced. However, Zhu had a different plan in mind. He wanted his team to engage with the vines to gain experience and rank up while he devised his own strategy to obtain the crystal fruit. Zhu instructed his team to focus on battling the vines, and he left to check on the other teams. The European team found themselves fighting against multiple vines, while the Eurasian Union team had called in fighter jets to combat the vines. Seeing this, George, the European team's captain, also decided to request fighter jets. Chaos reigned within the forest as the battle against the vines intensified. Zhu observed the tumult and, in response, summoned his dragon, Xiao. The other team leaders were shocked to see Zhu's dragon. Zhu and Xiao went even deeper into the forest, and Xiao unleashed his fiery breath to burn the vines. Zhu then descended from Xiao's back and retrieved the crystal fruit, declaring his Asian team as the mission's winners and all the other leaders lost. The scene shifted to the East Tower, where the director informed the chairman that Zhou Zheng and the rest would be returning soon. The chairman expressed his initial expectation of a prolonged struggle for the crystal fruit but was surprised that it had been secured in just a few days. As they spoke, they heard Zhao's roar, prompting the chairman to comment on the presence of the individual behind these events. Zhou arrived at the meeting with the chairman and the director. He handed them the crystal fruit, and the chairman explained its significance. He mentioned that one crystal fruit could transform an ordinary person into a martial artist, even allowing them to break through 10 stages. Zhou contemplated this revelation, realizing the resemblance between the crystal fruit and the experience fruit from the game. The chairman then informed Zhou about the rules of the Asian team, specifying that as the captain, he was entitled to 10% of the loot and presented three choices. First, to take 10% of the crystal fruit. Second, to select 10 kilograms of compound alloy metal from the Central Manufacturing Company's arsenal. Third, to convert the star crystal payment to his personal account. Zhou inquired about the effectiveness of the crystal fruit after being cut, and the chairman assured him that it had been proven. Zhou considered his options. While choosing 10% of the crystal fruit could boost his rank, he decided that the best choice at that moment was the second option, which entailed obtaining 10 kilograms of compound alloy metal from the Central Manufacturing Company. He reasoned that better equipment would enhance his chances of finding more crystal fruit. A year later, Zhou was riding on Zhao's back, flying toward Na Ban Forest in search of crystal fruit. His level had reached 185, and he opened his equipment windows system, contemplating that if he found just one more crystal fruit, the rogue's epic equipment set would make its debut. Zhou reached the forest, and about 100 kilometers ahead, he sensed the energy of the crystal fruit. Zhou noted that the crystal fruit in that location wouldn't be ripe for another half a year. Meanwhile, George was also in the forest, and he had set a trap using a fake crystal fruit. The ground was littered with explosives and flamethrowers. Holding the trap activator key, George thought, "Good, the trap is set up. Just need to wait for a rat to enter." He then instructed Lewis to gather his team and leave the area quickly, explaining that if the trap were activated within 3 kilometers, it would turn into a fiery inferno. George was confident that Zhou Zheng and his dragon wouldn't escape. A few minutes later, Zhou and Zhao reached the crystal fruit. As Zhou got closer to it, he realized that it was a fake. He immediately ordered Zhao to retreat. George then pressed the trap activator, causing a massive explosion in the area. Flamethrowers surrounded Zhao, preventing him from flying higher. Zhou and Zhao were hit by a barrage of missiles. George triumphantly stated, "Farewell, Asia's star. You should feel honored to die in this trap." As Zhou and Zhao fell to the ground, Zhou's life flashed before his eyes. He desperately thought, "No, I don't want to die like this. This can't be the end." He held his dragon, Zhao, close, determined to at least save him. Memories of his friends and family rushed through his mind as he apologized, and then he hit the ground, lifeless. After some time, the central city's TVs broadcasted the heartbreaking news. Asia's star, Zhou Zheng, had been confirmed dead in an attack. His friends gathered for Zhou's funeral, placing his clothes and armor in the coffin. Su Yun was in tears, mourning the loss of the young master. Lan Zai vowed to find the person responsible for Zhou's death and seek vengeance. George, the one who had killed Zhou, also attended the funeral. He commented, "Such a pity, Zhou Zheng, you fell at such a young age. But it's because you were too young, immature, arrogant, and didn't know your limits. That's why you died." Lan Zai, furious upon hearing this, was ready to start a fight. But Zhang held him back, advising that they were no match for one of the strongest people in Europe. George then addressed Lan Zai, "It seems like you're just like him." He warned that they would meet again next time, and he would teach Lan Zai a lesson then, before departing. The scene shifted as a bright light took on the shape of a human, and Zhou Zheng returned to life. Zhou was puzzled by the fact that he hadn't died. He considered whether it was due to the reborn ring he had, which had a 20% chance of reviving the wearer with full health upon death. However, he soon realized that he hadn't been reborn at the exact spot where he died, indicating it wasn't the ring's effect. Zhou thought to himself, "I obviously revived at Y City when I came to this world. It should be according to the rules of the game. This is the bound revival location." This led him to the conclusion that his revival was unrelated to the ring. With an evil smile, Zhou remarked that, just like in the game, even if he died, he'd be revived, only dropping one level. With a newfound determination and a thirst for vengeance, Zhou stood up, ready to exact retribution on those who had wronged him, pledging to repay them 100-fold. 2 months later, Zhou was decked out in his thief god equipment, and his class had evolved from rogue to thief. His level had now reached 200. Zhou whistled, and his dragon, Zhao, appeared, even bigger and stronger than before. Zhou remarked, "Now I've finally reached the maximum level in this world. Even though many years have passed since I came here, all those things that happened still feel like they were just yesterday. But the current me is no longer the same." With determination, Zhou told Zhao that it was time for them to return home. Upon returning to the central city, Zhou entered a bar and sat down with a masked man. Zhou ordered a beer and offered to treat the masked man. In gratitude, the masked man handed Zhou a piece of bread and praised its taste. Zhu cut the bread in half and discovered a small device containing information about George and his team. Zhu thought to himself, with these pieces of information, the performance is going to be much more exciting. The scene then shifted to Europe, where George and his team were hosting an event with many of their acquaintances. George addressed the attendees, expressing gratitude for their presence. He revealed the main content of the event, the death of Zhou Zheng, Asia's star and the captain of the Asia team, at his hands 2 months ago. The people in the room were stunned by this shocking news. Unbeknownst to George, Zhu was at the event using his stealth skill. He walked around confidently, seemingly enjoying the spotlight, and pondered how to make George's death memorable. While George and his friend Austin were in front of the bathroom, George suggested they enjoy the company of the top-notch ladies later. After George entered the bathroom, Austin waited outside. Unbeknownst to George, Zhu had set up a camera that was broadcasting the scene live in Europe, the Central City, and the Eurasian Union. While George was urinating, Zhu exited stealth mode and confronted him, asking if he remembered him. George was in shock, insisting that Zhu should have been burned to ashes. Zhu responded that sometimes ashes can rekindle. His actions shocked his team, family members, and leaders in the audience. George attempted to attack Zhu, but Zhu used his disturbance skill to immobilize him. He then teleported to George and killed him by stabbing him in the heart with a dagger. Zhu announced that this was the exciting show he had prepared and hoped that everyone would enjoy it. He proceeded to eliminate every member of George's team. Meanwhile, a counselor observed the situation and discussed the matter with a friend. They decided against sending support because even George had been easily killed by Zhu. They speculated that Zhu might change the world pattern with his actions. Zhu returned to where his friends were, and they rushed to embrace him. Zhu expressed his commitment to making a difference in the world, even though it wouldn't happen overnight. He vowed to do his best to protect his family, friends, and loved ones. Later, they visited Y City to see Zhu's father. Zhu went to his grave, saying, "Father, I've come back to see you. This place, Y City, the one you built, is where dreams begin, and it's also where the dream continues."